Hello, everyone. My name is Carol Ann Cord, and I'm the Director of Alumni Engagement at St. Elizabeth University. Months ago, Rosemary Carroll presented this interesting idea for an event that the university and the Seton Associates could host together about our faith and how that influences us as voters. So much has changed since Rosemary and I started our discussions about this important conversation. The first thing is that Rosemary has retired. She's now the Director Emeritus of the Seton Associates. I am so grateful that she has continued to promote and support this event. At the time, we never imagined we would be participating via Zoom and had planned to have a great crowd on campus. But when one door closes, another door opens. And hosting this event online has given us the opportunity to include participants from around the country. Thank you all for being here and for taking the time to log in from wherever you are. A special thanks to my boss, Joseph Eckert, Vice President of Institutional Advancement, Sister Maureen Shaughnessy, the General Superior of the Sisters of Charity, and Dr. Helen J. Strubert, the President of St. Elizabeth University, for being here tonight. To my coworkers at SEU, the Seton Associates, and the Sisters of Charity, thank you all. And I have so much gratitude for Father Anthony and his super helpful and wonderful team behind the scenes, Marina, Duggan, and Bob Kaplan. Before I introduce our speakers, I just wanted to let everyone know that Father will be answering questions after his presentation. If you have any questions during the lecture, you're invited to write them in the chat, and then we will let him know what those questions are once that time comes for the event. Now I am happy to welcome Sister Maureen Shaughnessy to say a few words.
Good evening, and welcome to this wonderful event, Living the Beatitudes of Jesus as a Voter 2020. There could be no more timely topic as we're now less than 30 days to Election Day. As Catholics, we believe the teachings of Jesus guide us in our daily living, and we look to them to give us insight into the complex issues of today. Cardinal Tobin, in a presentation he was really recently part of, reminded us that voting is a sacred act, and that there is a complexity to the issues facing us as citizens and voters today, and we cannot take this lightly. Our bishops remind us that no one party encompasses all of the teachings of the church. So we have much to sort, and I look forward to hearing tonight's presentation from Father Anthony. Thank you, Carolyn.
Thank you, Sister Maureen. Next, I would like to ask President Helen J. Strubert to address the group.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this wonderful opportunity to share our thoughts and to project where we will be 3, 4, 5 months from now. There's much to be gained from the conversation that we'll have tonight as we talk about our responsibility as Catholics and as citizens of the United States of America. We have so very much to look forward to. There's much hope on the horizon, and certainly the opportunity for us to influence the future as it goes forward. I echo Sister Maureen's comments with regard to our responsibilities and how each of us as Catholics need to look at the variety of opportunities that are before us as we enter the electorate. So tonight I say thank you. Thank you for your support of St. Elizabeth University. Thank you for your support of the Sisters of Charity. And thank you, Father Anthony, for joining us this evening and giving us the wonderful opportunity to hear your views on the subject at hand. Thanks, Caroline.
Thank you so much, Helen. And now I'd like to introduce Rosemary Carroll, the Director Emeritus and Associates, who will lead us in prayer and introduce our main speaker tonight, Father Anthony Randazzo.
Let us pray. We ask our divine creator, give us the grace to recognize and respond to all that is asked of us, particularly in service to the poor. We ask for our faithful guide and partner, Jesus, to guide us in gospel living, particularly in beatitude living. And we ask the Holy Spirit to rest in our hearts so that everything we say, think, do, pray reflects Trinitarian love. Amen. Father Anthony Randazzo has been the pastor at the Catholic Church of Holy Trinity in Westfield, New Jersey for the past 5 years. He is a native of Lodi, New Jersey, and a graduate of Don Bosco Prep and Seton Hall University. He studied theology at the University of Leuven in Belgium and earned a license in sacred theology from the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. Father Anthony was ordained in November 1986 and was assigned to Our Lady of Mercy Church in Jersey City, where he served 10 years. Then he served parishioners at Notre Dame Church in North Caldwell for 18 years. Father Anthony has been a guest lecturer in the Department of Theology at St. Elizabeth University and conducted workshops at the annual theology convocations. He presently serves on the university's prestigious, on the board of the university's prestigious Holocaust Center. Last month, Father Anthony participated in the Rite of Commitment, becoming a Seton Associate of the Sisters of Charity of St. Elizabeth. As a Seton Associate, Father Anthony walks with the Sisters and Seton Associates in service to the poor by living a life of charity. This evening, Father Anthony will illuminate the choices we encounter as we live the Beatitudes of Jesus as a voter. Father Anthony. Thank you.
Good evening to all. Healthy blessings. Different to begin a lecture on living the Beatitudes of Jesus as a voter with calming music. For all of us who are experiencing the effects of the pandemic during this year 2020, much has gone on in our hearts and in our minds. We need always to come into the calming presence of a loving spirit. This evening, my hope is to take us all on a journey so that we not only have a better understanding of the Beatitudes of Jesus, but that much of what we will share this evening becomes a gift to the soul, becomes a movement into how our soul life is essential to being a person, a parent, a spouse, a worker, a voter. We are fundamentally, as many have said, spiritual beings living human experiences. Thus, sisters and brothers, this evening, this title, Living the Beatitudes of Jesus as a Voter, has gone through many changes as I've developed this evening's lecture. At first, I thought it would be best to say revisiting the Beatitudes of Jesus as a Voter. Then I thought about informing the electorate about the Beatitudes of Jesus. Then I felt, well, no matter how we approach this topic, all of us in our learning, we are living, and ultimately all of us, as we listen to the Beatitudes, we come into that inner space, we come to the recognition that we can identify living some aspect of the Beatitudes in our lives. And as I go through this evening, my hope is that you will be convinced that you are already living the Beatitudes of Jesus in some personal and communal way. That if indeed you have a connection to a university that is fond of caritas, charity, that Beatitude living is indeed a part of your experience of life. This evening, I'd like to begin by taking you first to this opening, which is so very important for everyone to understand that as the Beatitudes are taught in the Gospel of Matthew, the longest gospel of the four Gospels, that people sometimes are not aware that the preamble to this Sermon on the Mount, beginning in chapter 5 to 7, that these verses right now are so significant. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. It is so vital to understand that this prophetic teacher is about the good news of the kingdom of God, and that that good news is not only a preached message, but an engaging message of kingdom actions. And one of those actions of the presence of God is how this Jesus in the Gospel of Matthew is teacher and healer. So his fame spread throughout all Syria, and they brought to him all the sick, those who were afflicted with various diseases and pains, demoniacs, epileptics, and paralytics, and he cured them all. And great crowds followed him from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and from beyond the Jordan. Sisters and brothers, this is a large picture. And for our times, as we go through this pandemic, what better understanding of seeing Jesus as teacher and healer, and his fame. As many an author has said, there was no one in antiquity who had so many stories of healing attached to his name than Jesus of Nazareth. Large crowds, great crowds, people coming from all directions. We will see that the Beatitudes are not just for one people. The Beatitudes and the message of the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew and the Sermon on the Plain in the Gospel of Luke, the message is for all people. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and he taught them, saying, he sat down. He came into that position, maybe for some we could call a lotus position. And his disciples, and he began to give them the profile. He began to be the man of the Beatitudes to give the disciples the vision, to give them an opportunity to see what the inner core, the beginning of the constitution of Christian discipleship is all about, and how this germinated out of the healing ministry of Jesus, the teaching ministry. And so these Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And we listened and we heard the music on the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes can come into our scope of understanding in so many ways. Way back in the day, in 2006, I co-authored a text entitled Beatitudes, Christ and the Practice of Yoga. And the yoga teacher that I worked this text with, she brought these Beatitudes to her meditation practice. And out of that meditation practice, she began to design a practice for yogic poses. The Beatitudes can come into our soul through many means. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the poor in heart, for they will see God. Peacemakers will be called children of God. Pope Francis has said countless times that it's not just a recitation of Beatitudes, that we need to place these Beatitudes into our hearts by memory. In the very first months, of Rome, his central teaching was to get across how important it is in catechesis that we have the foundations of the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes in this genre, these wisdom sayings, these very precise and short pieces of wisdom, that this ought to be very much a part of message, mission, and ministry. Pope Francis, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, repeated, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. We go to Luke, and we see those Beatitudes once again. And we see that Luke brings the Beatitudes worded a little bit different. Then he looked up at his disciples and said, the disciples are always in the audience of the Beatitudes. And we are the contemporary disciples. And at this time in history, as contemporary disciples, we are getting ready to do, as someone once called, the most non-violent act, but a great moral act, to vote. Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and when they exclude you, revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven. For that is what their ancestor did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets. Now we see the woes are later in the Gospel of Matthew, but Luke, in his own way, because he wants to drive home very distinctively the chasm that existed in that culture between rich and poor, Luke includes very poignantly this woe to the opposite of those who are poor. This evening's outline is this way. David Brooks, maybe some of you have heard about David. I have begun to read his text, The Second Mountain, and listen to Brooks and Shields, and we will see a little bit of David Brooks. I'll do some more general remarks on the Beatitudes, the realities of first century Palestine, because you can't understand the Beatitudes today if you do not understand the Beatitudes of back in the day. When Jesus taught them, we have to understand the Beatitudes back in the day in order to understand the Beatitudes today, and especially how important they are to draw them in as we prepare for the sacred duty of voting. What Beatitudes say about Jesus? Jesus is a teacher. We all know that the teacher is reflected in her or his teaching. what does it say about Jesus in the bigger picture? What is the historical Jesus? How do we rethink the Jesus of history? How do we see the Jesus of history in the 21st century, since we have tools that can bring to us a better understanding of the Jewish Jesus, the Jesus within Judaism, the Jesus who was a Palestinian Jew in the first century? And then the contemporary application as a voter, what does all this mean for now? And then we'll have some Q&A. David Brooks. You just move that over slightly, Bob. The second mountain, page 246. In fact, the gentleman who is conducting the PowerPoint with me gave me this book. You'll see this, all these books at the end will have a picture of a little bit of a bibliography that I have here. David Brooks, The Second Mountain, The Quest for Moral Life, The Second Mountain. And it's ironic that Jesus gives the Beatitudes, obviously, on the mountain and on the plain, David Brooks. On the other hand, I can't unread Matthew. The Beatitudes are the moral sublime, the source of awe, the moral purity that takes your breath away and toward which everything points. In the Beatitudes, we see the ultimate road map for our lives. There are a lot of miracles in the Bible, but the most astounding one is the existence of that short sermon. I have never read as concise a description that hits the mark on the deepest meaning and interpretation of the Beatitudes for today than what David Brooks includes here in the book, The Second Mountain. For as Father Rohr says, the Beatitudes are about second half of life living. The Beatitudes are the new commandments. The Beatitudes are not the commandments of the past. Jesus is the new Moses and gives the Beatitudes. The moral sublime. Just the other day in Fratelli Tutti, Tutti Fratelli, the Pope put out this letter on the day that we generally honor Francis of Assisi. The Pope said in the beginning paragraphs of this incredible new encyclical, moral consistency and spiritual identity. If you read the entire book, The Second Mountain, you will see that David is trying to help us with spiritual identity and moral consistency, and that consistency is truly reflected in the wisdom of the Beatitudes. David Brooks, in a lecture on August 16th, 2020, said, "We are culture builders." Now, in every respect, culture, with education, with medicine, with law, with language, with religion, with faith, there are so many dimensions of culture, the arts, the performing arts, dance. Culture has many dimensions. We are culture builders. What kind of culture are we building? Jesus was in a culture in the first century. We're in a culture in the 21st century. We say we have subcultures. We say we have an American culture. We say we have a world culture. We say we have a culture in the university. We say we have a corporate culture. Culture is a very huge understanding of how we human beings interact in our intersubjectivity, in our interdependence. And yet, what Brooks said in that lecture, that here in the United States, we are an individualistic culture. We seem to have hyper-individualism. We seem to have excessive individualism. We have a crisis of social solidarity. When it comes to the Beatitudes, it's all about solidarity. It's all about how Jesus is addressing the social realities of his times, the people, the populace, those who are living their lives in an economy, in a political reality, under Roman authority, living in Jewish Torah culture, the umbrella of Judaism over the occupation of Roman authority, political authority. In our country, Brooks says we have this crisis of social solidarity. But then, brilliantly, Brooks says in his book, The Second Mountain, resume virtues versus eulogy virtues. And this is something, quite frankly, as a presider at funerals, many funerals over many decades, probably now maybe about 1,600 or 1,700 services of Eucharist and services without Eucharist. I've heard many words of remembrance, and there's been controversy about words of remembrance, eulogy at Eucharist. But what is at stake here is that David says that we all have resume virtues, and we create a resume where we went to school, and what degrees we have, and what certificates we've achieved. And those are all very important resume virtues, but those are hardly the ones that come up when we pass away, the eulogy virtues. The virtues that I heard today at a funeral about a gentleman, and they said, yes, he was the kind of person that loved celebration. He was the kind of person that always sent out an invitation and drew people and had a great understanding of getting people together to celebrate life. In all the storytelling that we did today during the funeral service I had this morning, no one spoke at all about the man's accomplishments and his professional life. They centered in entirely on eulogy virtues. And I would propose that in the Beatitudes, the eulogy virtues or the eulogy values, whatever one would like to call these deeds, these mitzvot, they are essential to how we will be remembered when we leave this life. The personal journey with the Beatitudes. For me personally, it's been an incredible journey. It started way back when I did a sabbatical in 2006, and I began to really understand the Beatitudes ever more deeply. I had the opportunity during that period to visit Mexico, Cuernavaca. Was able to visit the Benedictine sisters in Cuernavaca. This was a program organized by the outstanding Weston Priory, the Benedictine monks. I went with a group of professors from Oregon, and we were with the sisters. And there I got another understanding of what it meant to be poor. I had never experienced the extent of what I was able to see and listening to the voices of the poor. I'd like to just share with you something from my diary and how then the Beatitudes, they make a difference when you begin to see names and faces in those wisdom sayings. They begin to really touch the heart. I wrote this many years ago. When you live in squalor, subhuman conditions, when you have a partial roof over your head and your floors are cement finished, you must dream about something better. Maybe the something better will not come in this lifetime. Your eyes turn to a heavenly kingdom. Poor people scrape up life from the little they have around them. They make goods and they sell them in order to have a few pesos for tortilla. Poor people take pride in their space, even though by our standards, they may be subhuman. People without resources try their best to survive each day, even when sick and disabled. Poor people want to live and enjoy life like everyone else. They do not necessarily choose their plight. Where they were born determined their future. Yes, that experience in Cuernavaca changed my entire understanding of what the Beatitudes about poor and poor in spirit, which is the Beatitude of Matthew, which says all of us in some way suffer a lack of and vulnerable. There's the material poverty, there's the spiritual poverty. But it came home to me in Cuernavaca what was at stake about those who, in our estimation, would be understood to be poor. Also, the Beatitude, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. I came to understand in Cuernavaca that the land is a hotly debated issue. And that when people are speaking, even in contemporary times, and when in Jesus's times, that power, politics, wealth were always weighing heavily on the use of land everywhere. Jesus favored those whose voices were muted by the talking heads governing and controlling at Jesus' time parcels of land. How could the meek, those who were illiterate and uneducated, possibly inherit the land? Jesus reversed it all. There are 8 different mindsets that I discovered in an article from Science and Spirit back in April 2002. And these mindsets give us an entrance into the deeper understanding of the Beatitudes, the time of Jesus, and in our times. The first mindset, and you could consider a mindset a worldview and how we come to life each day. It's difficult to define mindset. I've been asking people this, and it's an orientation, it's a disposition, it's the way perhaps we see things. One mindset of the 8 is entitled Centered in a Material World. This is universal, where a person lives their life totally centered in a material world, recognizing that they are more about wants than needs. Jesus in the Beatitudes is about needs. He's about the hungry. He's about the thirsty. Jesus is about needs. He's about how those who hunger, it's critical. The word hunger is a critical term in the Beatitudes. In fact, in the Pope's recent encyclical, says it's a moral imperative that we end hunger in the world. In fact, the Pope boldly suggests, and this is absolutely in line with the Beatitude understanding back then and now, is that we would take money that we would be placing to armaments, particularly nuclear arms, and take that money and have countries feed people. Jesus would approve that message. It's found in the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes were very much with people about their needs. Then another mindset that was noted in that article from Science and Spirit, and disengage from social concerns. Yes, in hyper-individualism, excessive individualism, we can be disengaged from social concerns. Now, this is where the Beatitudes of Jesus come into play, because Jesus was never disconnected from the social concerns. He was always in the larger world he was living in, the Jewish world, the influence of Hellenism upon that world. He was speaking of kingdom of God in that world. The Beatitudes are kingdom wisdom statements. He's always saying this world for these folks whose needs are not being met, ultimately, in the end, the blessings that he's sharing, being what many call an end time prophet, that if you don't receive the fullness of God's blessing now, you will get it at the end. The end blessing, what we call in very highfalutin theological language, eschatological blessing. Jesus was talking to people who had been healed, as was noted at the beginning. This is a very vast audience. Matthew is very clever to set the stage of who's listening to what Jesus is saying about hungry and thirsty. Then we have another mindset of those who are embracing traditional values, and values that we say are from our family, values that we say are American values, patriotic values, values, Catholic values. But what is offered in the Beatitudes are universal values. They go beyond any ethnic designation. They go beyond any religious denomination. The values emerging in this shame and honor culture, in this culture in Judaism, which was in the middle of purity and impurity, in this foreign occupation classification culture, it goes beyond just embracing traditional values that come down to us. Jesus of Nazareth had the larger picture of the kingdom of God values. And then another one of these mindsets, connecting through self-exploration. Blessed are the poor of heart, for they shall see God, the pure of heart. That had nothing to do with the ritual purity. Jesus wasn't really concerned about that. He was a strict Jew, but he didn't say a lot about ritual purity. He said much more about how the intention within got expressed in deeds. Mitzvah, singular. Mitzvot, deeds, plural. Blessed are the poor of heart, for they shall see God. The pure of heart, the self-exploration, connecting to that and understanding that the deeper we go, the more the Beatitudes make sense. Another mindset that's out there, and I think it's a mindset that's very present right now, persisting through adversity. We're living through a pandemic, and the people of the time, you understood that the people were suffering with all kinds of contagious diseases during Jesus' time. All kinds of orthopedic diseases, very common eye diseases, because of all the dust, there was a lot of issue with eyes, a lot of blindness, a lot of mobility issues, persisting through adversity. Jesus knew that that was in the psyche of the people he was addressing. Therefore, the Beatitudes always have underneath them that you're going to make it, that there'll be some happiness, that happy are those. That's what the very word means. Beatus that we sang at the beginning, the Latin term beatus, the happy attitudes, as Father Rohr calls them, the happy attitudes, persisting through adversity. All the Beatitudes are trying to stir up that in the midst of things not being fair, in the midst of life being not that easy, that in this vulnerability, that God has our back. As they say, God has our back in the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted, persisting through adversity. I cannot say enough about that. I must include this, and this is for another lecture. When they look at the Beatitudes, and they try to discern which Beatitudes ultimately came from the mouth of Jesus of Nazareth, and which Beatitudes may have come from a particular source within the Gospel of Matthew, the one that most are convinced Jesus uttered was, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." That understanding, that compassion, that ultimate seeing that no matter what persuasion that Jesus had, and there was a lot of diversity in front of him, if you listen, they were coming from all directions, that ultimately that they were woven together through their grief. Mary Robinson here in Westfield, who is noted as a CNN hero, Mary said that just recently we had a webinar with Mary. She said, not only are we suffering a pandemic, but we are suffering a pandemic of grief. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. That's our job as a disciple of Jesus of Nazareth. That's our mission. That's our mission, to comfort those who cry. In fact, the Pope said it beautifully one day. He said, when people shed their tears, they break open the soul. Tears breaking open the heart deeply for relationship with God and others. Those are the Pope's words. Let me repeat that. Tears breaking open the heart deeply for relationship with God and others. That's the kind of message that's within the Beatitudes. That's the kind of core profile framework that is to inspire our daily living. Father Ron's 10 Commandments for Living. Who is Father Ron? Father Ron is Father Ron Rollheiser. Father Ron I met many days ago when I was a student back in Leuven. And Ron Rollheiser was studying for his doctorate. Kept up with Ron through the years, and just recently, Ron gave an inaugural lecture at Yale in memory of a very beloved friend, Father Bob Boulogne. If you go on the website at Yale, particularly in the ministry to Catholic students, you will find the name of Father Bob Boulogne. Well, Father Bob Boulogne needed to be honored in a special way, and Father Ron was invited to give the inaugural lecture in memory of Father Bob Boulogne. And these, he gave 10 commandments, but commandment 2 and commandment 4 help us with Beatitudes. The second commandment of Father Ron: link all your growth in your learning to an equal growth in compassion. Be wise and not just bright. Keep in mind, he's giving this at Yale. Link all growth in your learning to an equal growth in compassion. Jesus approves that message. Be wise and not just bright. Jesus approves that message too, because he was talking about wisdom. He was talking about prophetic wisdom. He was talking about how things get reversed. He was talking about an alternative vision of life. Not just bright. You can have all the credentials in the world and miss the Beatitudes. You can have all the credentials in the world and not understand the Beatitude teacher, Jesus of Nazareth. Commandment number 4. Now this, Ron didn't, I don't think, knew this. This was pre-pandemic. Try to inoculate yourself against ideology. Don't be a liberal and don't be a conservative. Be compassionate and go where that takes you. Ah, sisters and brothers, this is at the core. This is the brilliance of Father Ron. Let me repeat that. Try to inoculate yourself against ideology. Jesus of Nazareth had to inoculate himself against the ideologies of his time, which took the law sometime to extreme. Jesus was a Torah teacher. He was a teacher that interpreted the law. He was someone who understood the law, and particularly in the Gospel of Matthew, according to Father Donald Sr. from Chicago, you don't talk law in Matthew unless you talk compassion. Try to inoculate yourself against ideology. Don't be a liberal. Don't be a conservative. Be compassionate and go where that takes you. Sisters and brothers, that has been the art of compassionate living, is the art of the Beatitude. The art of listening to the suffering heart is the art of Beatitude living. And everyone who's listening, you've done it. You have done it. You have done it. The marginal Jew, John Meyer. Now, in other lectures, I have brought these books with me, The Marginal Jew. This is only one volume. Part of how I've been formed theologically and in biblical interpretation, I owe a good amount of that formation to John Meyer, Father John Meyer, Notre Dame University. I met Father John back on a journey to the Holy Land. It was a group of scholars. I was just a student, literally a disciple of these great scholars like John Meyer. Five volumes, A Marginal Jew. This is so extensive. These volumes are stacking. And John still has two more that he's going to be putting out. But The Marginal Jew, let me tell you a few things, because once you understand this, then you understand why living the Beatitudes of Jesus as a voter is very relevant for our times, understanding the marginal, underlining, marginal Jew. This is a summation of carefully reading the volumes. Father John started writing in 1991. His last volume came out in 2016. One of my hobbies is I keep reading and reading and rereading. And after a lot of reading, these points, now this gives the Beatitudes the dimension that so often is missed. The first thing, the Jesus of history does not have a political agenda as understood from his Palestinian context. He uses the term the kingdom of God, kingdom of heaven in Matthew. There's no political agenda. When we talk about the Beatitudes of Jesus, it's not identity politics. It's not policy making. It's not geared toward one candidate or another. There is no political agenda in the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes come from someone who was living, as you will see in just a moment, with this very fine word, halakhic Jew. He's living and he's telling the people, you might want to consider this for how you live and who you should be aware of within your own body and who is on the margins. The Jesus of history does not have a political agenda. Second, Jesus faces in his times political tensions and debates stemming from two spheres, Torah practice and civic life. As John says, Jesus was a fierce debater. This is the Jesus of history. You couldn't be a good Jew and not debate the law. You couldn't be a good Jew and not be debating with people. And we see the other people of the time that Jesus enters into the fray with the Pharisees, more with the Pharisees than with the Sadducees. We see that Jesus is engaging on divorce, on the prohibition of divorce, the prohibition of taking an oath. Jesus said, don't prohibiting an oath. That is to say, you don't come in and swear and bring God into something and swear truth in the front of God. You don't bring God into truth telling. You don't bring God into that because you're in some way dishonoring God by taking an oath. This is first century understanding. Jesus becomes, now this is the critical point. Jesus becomes the victim of a political system wishing to keep the masses calm and compliant. That's an essential part. Now, Jesus is the victim of a system. Jesus is a crucified criminal at the end. Jesus is the one who preaches the kingdom of God, but is named King of the Jews. This is where the dilemma lies, and this is where the next volume, we're all waiting for John to do this, the reasons for the death of Jesus. The reasons for the death of Jesus. The historical reasons. As this unfolds, Jesus does not exclude anyone from his public ministry. This is the beginning of the public ministry in the Gospel of Matthew. This is, if you look at the Gospel of Matthew, it's broken up into five discourses. The first discourse is the Sermon on the Mount. The second discourse is basically how you go into mission, how the mission of discipleship is then lived out. Then you have the miracles, the telling of the miracles of Matthew. Then you have the community, how the Matthean community, how they begin to become church. And you see that in the community discourse. And in the last part of the Gospel of Matthew, you have what they call the eschatological discourse. These five sections of Matthew mimic the Pentateuch because the primary audience in the Gospel of Matthew is Jewish. Its substrata, as we call it, is Jewish. So Jesus does not exclude anyone from his public ministry, not just the marginalized. Jesus addresses everyone in all different parts of his experience, his miracles, and his teachings, and his personal touch are for everyone, even for the centurion who is seeking the healing of the centurion's servant. Jesus was always pushing the boundaries of his times, this Jesus of history. The rethinking the Jesus of history is a phenomenal way of understanding our times. Socioeconomic considerations of first century Palestine. A typical example is a person who is trying to live and kind of just get by, squeak out an existence in this world. Basically, if they were in the agricultural society of the Galilee, fertile land, and worked on a farm, they were mainly not the farm owners. They were not the land owners, the masses. They worked in order to provide food for their families and do what we do today, pay taxes, a lot of taxes. They paid taxes to the empire. They paid temple taxes. They paid taxes to the Jewish king. They were taxed and taxed. So these folks in this time, their poverty was a material poverty because they were into the mode of just making it. Now Jesus chooses in this socioeconomic setting, he chooses fishermen along the Sea of Galilee because they're at a different part of the economic ladder at the time. The fishermen can provide. I know a little bit about a fishing culture, being the son of a fisherman, and my father having grown up in a fishing village in Sicily. Sicily, as you know, is not that far from the Middle East. And the boats that originally my father was on as a young boy and his father as a fisherman were not unlike the boat that came up not too long ago, which they discovered there in Israel from back in the first century. But the point about fishermen and the economy was that they lived off of the sea. And they brought in some means. But the fishermen, and this is something that we don't really know, at the end of the day, the fishermen could, there was no refrigeration. Well, my father was a fisherman in Italy decades ago. The stories would be you peddled the fish, and then at the end of the day, you gave the fish to people who could not buy the fish because it would spoil. So in these times that Jesus is living in, there is a Hellenistic reciprocity that's present. I do this for you, you do this for me. But Jesus was introducing something that you do for others because you're doing on behalf of the actions of the kingdom of God, where the power is not economic power. It's not political power. It's the power of God who elects the people, in the Jewish mindset, elects the people, comes into a covenant relationship with the people, expects a response in that covenantal love, and that response is doing good deeds in the name of the one who establishes the covenant, the God of the kingdom. So there is no human who can substitute for this kind of power. It is divine power. Judaism and its praxis in the first century was a praxis that was around a monotheism because surrounding were temple, were shrines to other gods. Jesus was a healer, but there were in the vicinity, in the zone, there was a shrine to Asclepius, who was known for healing. So Jesus is in this being a prophet, a healer, a charismatic religionist, charismatic. Every author would say there's a charism in this. Jesus is the original Jewish Jesus that's living the law, interpreting the law, giving the law nuance, combining law and love in the new commandment. This is quite a tradition that encircles the core vision of the Beatitudes. What Beatitudes say of Jesus of history, prophet of the end times. You almost hear people today say, are we living in the end times? You know, so many different things are happening, whether it be devastating impact of climate change. Yes, I mean, when things are happening like this, when people are living in the first century, and they're oppressed and they're not getting anywhere and they're depressed. They're oppressed and depressed. And that I think we're knowing something about that during pandemic times, oppressed, depressed. The same thing in Jesus's times, Jesus is saying the end is near. Jesus was saying there's something of God's presence that has already happened, and there's more of God's presence that's coming sooner than you think. That was in the mindset of Jesus of Nazareth, a teacher of wisdom, not a Greek cynic, not a revolutionary, not, as I said, a political activist, not someone who was a lobbyist, none of that. He's a teacher, he's a prophetic teacher of wisdom that sees the wisdom as an ethic and as a politic. And that you take the wisdom, you live the wisdom. You just don't remember the saying, you live out the wisdom. Jesus, as a halakhic Jew, John Meyer says this, he says, everyone who's ever studied the Jesus of history has to be aware of halakha. And that one must always say, they must repeat in their dreams, John says, you have to repeat in your dreams, Jesus is a halakhic Jew. Jesus is a halakhic Jew. And that the more you understand that Jesus is a halakhic Jew, the more you don't read into the New Testament, the more you extract from the New Testament that which is so important for our times. Jesus' ethics and politics. Now, as we get closer to coming into all that this means to being a voter, you know, everyone to some degree or another has tried to do some of this. Just recently, in fact, the person who I want to make mention of, because I would hope that people would take a look at what Bishop McElroy said in his talk on February the 6th at the University of San Diego, the Harper Center for Catholic Thought and Culture. That talk was entitled Conscience, Candidates, and Discipleship in Voting. Now, I've read his talk. In fact, I called his office when this talk came out and just expressed the gratitude for how well this talk. You can find this on the internet. Conscience, Candidates, and Discipleship in Voting. Gave a talk February the 6th, 2020. And very much in line with what Sister Maureen said about Cardinal Tobin, the same kind of an understanding about how the ethic and the politic is founded. They use more the term of Catholic social teaching. See, for me, I want to take it way further back in Catholic social teaching, to the origins of Jesus' teaching. Jesus' teaching is the foundation for anything we could call today Catholic teaching. You got to have the Jesus foundation. The Jesus foundation in general questions, because certain things Jesus did not address in specific Catholic ethical questions. But he did address my all-time most important beatitude, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called daughters and sons of God. Now that is, the Pope said it the other day, that this is essential, that in order to have peace, we must have dialogue. And that's what the Jesus ethics and politic, they're inseparable. It's always, how do we dialogue? How are we forming conscience? And that's what the Bishop of San Diego, how do we form conscience? We form conscience by disciple, knowing what the framework, the Beatitudes, that is the moral center of how we form a conscience. In fact, I've been debating this with some folks as far as whether or not we need to use the word conscience and just say soul. The moral soul. I think more people understand soul because conscience sometimes, and this can be debated, we can get into all kinds of classic debates about exactly what is conscience. We speak more about consciousness today than conscience. So I like the word soul more, the moral soul formation, as we're acknowledging the soul, because we will acknowledge the soul more deeply when we engage the actions, which we are already doing to one degree or another, but we have to listen to how we're engaging that. Faithful citizenship, the document, comes out from American bishops. In fact, as Sister mentioned with Cardinal Tobin, he took 50 pages of the Faithful Citizenship document from the American bishops and synthesized it beautifully in his letter in the Beatitudes of Jesus. See, for me, when I read a document of any kind, I sift it through this filter on the Beatitudes. That for me is foundational, formational, and transformational. The Beatitudes are formational, transformational, personal, and communal. You cannot be a peacemaker unless you have peace within. As Thich Nhat Hanh says, you become a peacemaker if you have peace within. That goes back to the soul. We can be arguing about all kinds of things, but if the people who come to the table to negotiate on a reduction of arms are not coming from a peaceful center, quite frankly, nothing's going to be done for peacemaking. Peacemaking. Before we get to the question and answer period in just a few moments, I want to bring your attention to two other texts that have indeed framed this, called U.S. Moral Theology from the Margins, edited by Charles E. Curran and Lisa A. Fuller. And in this text, you will find articles under Part 5, Poverty and Economic Inequality, Social Conscience and Politics in the United States of America, by Mary Joan Bain. Pope Francis, Women and the Church for the Poor, by Lisa A. Fuller, the co-editor of Charles Curran. If you know anything about Charles Curran, you know his reputation. U.S. Moral Theology from the Margins. Why are we always talking about the marginal Jew, the margins, the marginalized, those who are on the side corners of life? It seems to be, we keep repeating this because it's at the center of the Beatitudes. Now, since we are of the college, the University of St. Elizabeth, the sister that I've been looking at very carefully these days, not a sister of charity, but a Sister Simone Campbell, and I think many have great admiration for Sister Simone Campbell. She wrote a text, just came out, Hunger for Hope, Prophetic Communities, Contemplation, and the Common Good. That's precisely, I can't say it any better than that. That's at the core of the Beatitudes, creating prophetic community, contemplation, as we began at the beginning, to take it easy, ease into the soul and before we listen and before we learn, and common good. That's the very principle of all the Beatitudes, that are always taking in consideration not just the individual, but the common good. Person, community, community within person. But now, let me share with you something Sister says, and I'm going to end the remarks before the question and answer with a very beautiful story that really just happened to me a few hours ago and took my breath away. This is what Sister says. Politicians and their staff often prefer that lobbyists provide statistics and numbers as we advocate for policy. Sister has done some advocating, if you know anything about Sister Simone. Let me repeat that. Politicians and their staff often prefer that lobbyists provide statistics and numbers as we advocate for policy. We need to have the data available. But data, I have found, has never changed a mind, a heart, or a policy position. Rather, what has made a difference in my experience are the stories of real people and an alternative vision. Storytelling is the most powerful tool to engage compassion and make change. Jesus would approve that paragraph. That's at the core of the Beatitude message. Let me tell you a story to end before we go into the Q&A, before we have some music at the end from Sweet Honey from the Rock. Today, after the funeral, we went by cortege. This gentleman, William Reed, his loving family came together, and we had to go out. The gentleman had decided to be cremated, so his remains were in this urn, and the lead car from Higgins and Bonner led us to Mount Olivet Cemetery in Newark. I had never been to Mount Olivet Cemetery in Newark. Well, when we came into the cemetery, as we were getting ready to enter the entrance, there was a young lady there standing with a sign, a white young lady, homeless and hungry. As soon as I looked over to her, she said two words to me, "Oh, I'm sorry." And then quickly took down the sign and went off. And we went into the cemetery. Well, after we had completed the rite of committal, the voice said to me, "I have to get to this person." So when I'm leaving the cemetery by the same entrance was also the exit there at Mount Olivet, this is not an easy section of Newark. So I said, God, if you want me to find this young lady, she must have been in her 30s. I said, she's going to be there. So I leave the cemetery and I don't see her. So I go back and I said, God, if you want me, maybe she's somewhere. I said, if you want me to chat with this lady, she's going to be there. So I went out, sure enough, eye contact. I said to her, cross the street, I'll meet you on the other side. Well, I went to the other side. I said to her, tell me your story. Tell me your story. So she said, you know, I'm from Pennsylvania. I had a very serious crystal meth addiction. I mean, this young lady looked like any young lady, any mother here in Westfield. And as she's telling me the story, I say, tell me more. She says, yeah, I've been abused. I've been raped. I said, well, she said, I had to leave a boyfriend who was abusing me. I said, who are you with now? She said, I'm with this other guy. I said, you know, this area here is not a good area to be around. I said, I'm going to give you some money. Let's put that aside. I'm going to give you some money, but when I give you the money, I want you to make me a promise. You take down your sign and leave this area. She said, yeah, I know, because I'm getting propositioned here, and these guys are asking me to do that. I say, and she starts tearing up. And I honestly, behind glasses, sunglasses, and a mask, were both tearing up. So I said to her, I said, well, you don't want to go with this guy tonight. Okay, you're too vulnerable a person. You want to go, you say, you know, some women, say, go to the women tonight. Go to the women. Don't stay with this guy. Go to the women. I said, do you have any family? She said, no, I've severed all the ties. I have a son. The son is now with my mother. He's 13 years old. I said, what is your name? She said, Becky is my name. I said, okay, Becky. Well, this is, I said, no, I'm going to give you this money, but I want you to show me your sign again. She shows me this sign, homeless, hungry, want to survive, is what I remember on the sign. It's a little sign. I said, you can't stay around here. don't stay around here because it's going to be trouble for you here because this is rough around here. I said, but before I'm going to give you this money, so you got to get it, you got to leave here. He said, okay, I'm going to do that, no problem. I said, the last thing I'm going to do is I want to bless you. Is that okay? So this was the blessing. I said to her, the blessing is about your safety and security. So if you stay here, so we're asking God that you remain safe and secure and that you come to understand that you are the image of God. So I want you to understand the blessing. You are the image of God. She started tearing up. I started tearing up. I said, I'm going to put my hand on your head and bless you. So you got to get out of here. Don't ever forget, you are the image of God. Sisters and brothers, that's what the Beatitudes taught me. That every person on the planet is the face of the living God. No matter what they believe, no matter what ideology, no matter what they've done, no matter what their past is, if we take a moment to go soul to soul, we are about the life of the Beatitudes, and we will come to the polls. McElroy says, have Jesus sitting with you when you come to the poll. When you come to the polls, your ballot, sending your ballot. I'd say you don't need Jesus to sit with you. You just listen to a person like Becky, and you will come to the polls with the heart of the Beatitudes. Thank you.
We have one question so far, and it's just please explain the meaning of Jesus as a halakha.
Yes, that's an excellent question. The word halakha means law. It also means to take a walk, walk in law, living the walk, the halak, the full Torah understanding. One has to understand Jesus is living in a society, in a Jewish ambiance, where the law is 24/7. There is no separation between church and state, as we say today. There is no separation between Jewish life and civic life. The temple is at the core, not only of the Jewish world at the time, when Jesus goes up to the temple, but also it's at the center of the economy. A lot of things were happening, buying and selling and bartering were happening. So halakhic ultimately means that Jesus is not a Christian. He's bona fide, observant, Palestinian Jew who knew the law, read the law in some ways, because many people think he was literate, not illiterate, debated the law, and absolutely, because of his ways of interpreting the law, alienated religious authorities and alienated political authorities, or he never would have been on the cross if he did not alienate the collusion between the civic authorities and the religious authorities. Because when you have a movement, Jesus begins a movement. He didn't begin a church, he began a movement. And that movement has ramifications in a wider society. And that movement is founded in Jewish spirituality, Jewish law, Jewish culture, Jewish habits, Jewish everything of the first century.
I have a question.
Please.
I talk to a lot of friends who say, you know, as a Catholic, they don't feel connected or like either party really speaks to them for this election. And they feel conflicted because they think it's important to vote. You know, in that case, do you feel like abstaining from voting is a proper form of not necessarily protest, but of you know, living your faith.
Yeah. See, Carolyn, my response comes from John Robert Lewis. And Congressman Lewis and all the people that did all that they did for the Voting Rights Act, all the people that everywhere in the world have laid down their lives, particularly even women, with women's suffrage, the right to vote. So I would never judge someone abstaining from voting, but I would say truly that because of all the people in history who have tried to secure a vote for the benefit of the common good, that it's a sacred privilege, and one needs to pray very carefully about abstaining from it, since it is a sacred privilege, and many people have laid down their lives for that privilege, particularly people in the women's suffrages movement, and also a person like John Robert Lewis.
Question here. How do you decide who to vote for when each candidate has some pros and cons when it comes to taking care of others?
I agree that each candidate has pros and cons. At the same time, one has to not only look at policy, look at person, look at community, look at experience. I don't think anyone, like, for example, there is this whole thing, and I could say both sides, Catholics for Trump or Catholics for Biden. To me, that's not the way to approach this. For me, I'm part of the Jesus Party. So I'm not going to say Republican or Democrat because they both have major flaws. At the same time, I would say from everything that I've said, in that moment, through prayerful discernment, when a person is forming whatever moral conscience they're forming, and they're looking into the soul, the Spirit should help them with that decision. That's about all I can say about that.
So a question from, I think it's Sister Cecilia. How do we handle one issue voting?
Well, we basically, I would say, push that understanding aside, because if it was one issue voting, there wouldn't be enough Beatitudes. It's not ever one issue, ever. It has to be a multifaceted understanding of contemporary complex issues. That's why Jesus, if he just said one thing, the whole moral teaching of the New Testament has different foundational understandings, particularly justice. If justice is at the core of Matthean value system, justice, di kaiosune, and that means right relationship with God, right relationship in community. So one issue voting, monolithic voting, cannot honestly be the way a Christian disciple approaches the sacred privilege of voting. It cannot be, because Jesus is larger than that, than one issue, always been larger. Okay. Sisters and brothers, thank you very much for your attention. We're ending this a little bit sooner. We're going to end this with a piece from Sweet Honey on the Rock. But before we play that piece, what I'd like to do is share with you the last prayer that is part. There's two prayers at the end of the encyclical that the Pope just put out the other day. And I'd like to share that with you. In fact, it works perfectly. Rosemary prayed a beautiful prayer to the Creator God. And this prayer is called a prayer to the Creator. This is the prayer that ends the Pope's most recent encyclical. Lord, Father of our human family, you created all human beings equal in dignity. Pour forth into our hearts a fraternal spirit and inspire in us a dream of renewed encounter, dialogue, justice, and peace. Move us to create healthier societies and a more dignified world, a world without hunger, poverty, violence, and war. May our hearts be open to all the peoples and nations of the earth. May we recognize the goodness and beauty you have sown in each of us, and thus forge bonds of unity, common projects, and shared dreams. May the world share the dream of Jesus of Nazareth, the Beatitudes, because they are truly, at least for me personally, sweet honey from the rock.
Blessed
are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed
are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted.
Blessed
are the meek,
for
they shall inherit the earth.
Blessed are they
who are hungry and thirsty, they shall be filled.
Blessed
are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
Blessed are
they shall see God.
Blessed
are the peacemakers,
for
they shall be called the children of God.
Blessed are they
who are persecuted for righteousness' sake.
Theirs
is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed
are ye when men shall revile you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before
Blessed
are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed
are they that
mourn,
for they shall be comforted.
Blessed
are the
meek,
for they shall inherit the earth.
Thirsty,
they shall be filled.
Blessed
are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy.
They
shall see God.
Blessed
are the peacemakers, for they shall be called children of God.
Blessed are they
who are persecuted for righteousness' sake.
Theirs
is the kingdom of heaven.
Blessed are ye
when men